Hi, my name is Ben Callahan. I'm the founder of Sparkbox, and I was inspired to create this course on enterprise design system thinking because I wanted to get at the root of the real hard problems in design systems. And those are people problems, not technical ones. In this course, we'll cover the anatomy of a design system, how a design system matures, we'll talk about design system origin stories and a framework for maintaining stability, and we'll wrap up with a conversation about how an organization's culture impacts the approach you should take with your system. My goal with this course is that you and your team will ship higher quality products faster. I hope you enjoy the course. So in my experience, it's actually not a very good approach to force people to adopt your system, to require it. Although I definitely have seen organizations do this, and occasionally they can kind of make their way through it. It's actually really tricky to do that and to have that adoption last. So instead, I think it's much better to make something, you know, to make a system that the people want to use. And we've talked kind of a bit about that throughout the day. But really, if you've done the work to understand what's important to your subscribers, remember that's that engagement piece. If you've listened to their input, if you've listened to their feedback and asked them to participate to help shape the project, you're going to build something that solves their problems and doesn't make their work harder. And that's kind of the key to making something they're going to want to use. So the top challenge here in stage two is to evolve the system to show value to potential subscribers, right? You're trying to not only support the ones who are on board already, but you're now thinking about who uses the system that is, or who could use the system that doesn't yet, and what are the things that are important to them. So this means you've got to be really strategic about how you approach the evolution of your system. And actually the same kind of approach, you kind of remember this approach that we took early on, right? Where we took that color system for one specific subscriber group, and maybe we made that work across a whole set of subscriber groups. Now you've probably, if you followed that same pattern, you've taken that work and you've maybe expanded it a little, and maybe you found some other areas where you could do the same kind of thing. And that maybe was your first release. So now you're trying to grow that adoption, right? You're needing really to kind of push hard on engagement with those potential subscriber groups and understand what they need and keep expanding into other areas. Your goal is to be really kind of selectively filling out this area as much as makes sense for your organization in a way that helps you organically grow the adoption. This is kind of how you take the approach of building a system people want to use. And if you're really creative, you can make a lot of progress here. I remember one story that I had with one gentleman I was doing an interview with, and he was a designer, and it was kind of a design-led system. And he had gotten the budget to hire one front-end developer, and he had done a bunch of work in, like, you know, some design tools, and the front-end dev came in and they actually coded out some really cool components, HTML only to start with, web only to start with. And they were having a hard time getting devs to really be interested in using it. And so, you know, he just started kind of like showing up to the open door stuff their dev team had. He was just sitting and listening to the conversations. And before every meeting started, he noticed they were talking about the devs really wanting to do open source work. And so he heard that in several meetings. So he went back to his boss and he was like, "How would you feel about us open sourcing the design system?" And his boss was like, sure. You know, they kind of took a look at it and made sure there was nothing in there they couldn't, you know, release. They got a version of it out in open source, and literally within weeks, he had developers interested in not just using it, but contributing to it. So that's just a really creative way to kind of like figure out, like, what is it that these folks want? What is it that they actually need? And how do we come alongside them, understand those needs, and evolve the system in a way that makes sense, you know? I love that, but I'll also just say that's not enough. It's not enough to build a system that is just what people want, because you're also asking them to change. And changing their workflows does take time, right? It does take effort. And so one of the things that I think when I first did this work, one of the things I thought I would be able to identify was like a percentage threshold of some measure of adoption that means you've got enough people using the system that you can move on to other stage three type concerns. But it turns out like some teams move into stage three very quickly, and some almost they'll get lots of people using the system, but they still aren't actually thinking about anything other than adoption. And it turns out that the thing that sort of really actually helps you identify when that mindset shifts is actually not what you thought it would be. It's not some threshold of users or adopted or subscriber groups or something. Instead, it's actually thinking about the level of effort that it takes to onboard a single subscriber. And over time, what we see is if I do the work to make the level of effort for one subscriber to come on as a new user to the system, over time, that means I can actually allow for more users to come on. And my time is saved because it's easier for them. They're more willing to come on because it's easier for them. I've also made the job easier for me and my team, you know? So it's like a weird sort of thing, but this is actually one of the keys to getting users to come on board and stay on board of your system. So the way this works is that cultures which are diagonal from each other are like oil and water. They don't work well together. So if your organization has a creative, entrepreneurial, kind of do things first culture, this disruptive, create adhocracy culture, it's gonna be really hard for you to succeed down in this bottom left as a design system with a control culture, okay? The reason is because the creative culture is about disruption, right? While the controlling culture is saying, we know the right way and we have got it for you. So these two ideas are just incompatible. It's like trying to swim upstream if you're trying to operate in the control model and your organization is creative. So I actually have a fun story. I was doing an interview with a woman who led the design system for a really large web-based product in the job market space. And she told me this kind of fun story. She said that when she began there, the company was in startup mode. So they were up in that top right? The company was like trying to figure out what their product would be. They recognized though that the interfaces in their product were really inconsistent. So they felt that a design system was what was needed to get them through those inconsistencies, to get them under control. So the system they built was intentionally limiting. They built something in that bottom left. So they did this without any of this knowledge. They just intuitively thought, this is what we need. So their hope was that they were going to force the product teams to use the same components and felt that those teams would be able to do everything they needed with little or no extension. What it turns out, though, that the startup mindset, that creative culture of the organization meant they were constantly pivoting their direction in search of a product market fit. So the pivots in the product were the reason for the inconsistency in the interfaces, right? And that was actually valid changes they were making to try and find a fit. So when they offered this design system to the product teams that was wildly limiting, very inflexible, basically they just couldn't get anybody to use the thing, right? It was like, not gonna happen. They just built what they needed outside of the system. Here's what she told me at the end of that interview. I showed her all of this and she was like, oh my gosh, you just explained what happened to me. And she said, here's what she said. I wish we would have recognized the need for flexibility in the system as a way of supporting the necessary pivots the company was taking to find our place in the market. That would have built trust with our subscribers as an enabling tool instead of a restrictive one. Right, so what she was describing, without actually knowing it, was that she should have been more intentional in creating this collaborative design system subculture, right? She should have been operating in the top left of this graph. And these two cultures are actually compatible. Now, the opposite diagonal is incompatible as well. So if your company is competitive, right, you're in this do things fast market culture, it's going to be really hard for your design system program to succeed if you're trying to do so as a collaborative, do things together kind of culture. In fact, if you remember the story that I told you at the beginning of this culture section, right, about the organization that we walked away from after working with them for a year because of cultural incompatibility, this is kind of what I was seeking in my research, was to try and understand what had happened with us. And our client in that situation was definitely in that bottom right. And we, as a service company, as you know, kind of led by me with my own sort of collaborative values influencing us, we definitely try to take that top left approach in a lot of our work. We come alongside teams, right? We sit in the trenches with them and we do the work together. And what we were trying to do was build a collaborative culture, subculture, inside of a competitive organizational culture. And it felt like oil and water. I mean, it was so hard, you know, it just was not gonna work. I'm not saying that completely explains everything in my situation, but my takeaway is that we have to, me personally, I have to recognize when we're working with more competitive cultures and make adjustments to how we work to better align with what they need from us. These two cultures are compatible. And I wonder sometimes now if we had taken a more control approach in our system work, if we would have been able to find a way to kind of work through those incompatibilities. This, I think, would have felt more like we were swimming with the current instead of against it. So my big takeaway from this stuff is that we kind of have to look up from the work, right? We've got to look around and understand that all of these forces really are actually at play. You can try to fight against this, but it's really hard, it's really exhausting, and oftentimes it just won't work. So understand that the cultures and subcultures in your organization, be intentional about forming your own subculture in a way that gives it a chance at success.